Please tell us about yourself.
Well, I'm an old anarchist writer who lives in Eugene. I've been here since 81. Spent a lot of time in California. Yeah, I mainly write and do a weekly radio show, Anarchy Radio. And I like the Pacific Northwest and about it, I guess.
How did you first get involved with anarchism?
I first got involved with anarchism in the 60s. I was in the Bay Area in San Francisco and Berkeley back in the 60s. Well placed. It was a lucky place to be. I'd just gotten out of college in Haight-Ashbury, Berkeley, those exciting days. Although it wasn't, in the U.S. here, anarchism wasn't very much a part of the situation explicitly. I think it was really, even among the sort of communist groups, they were somewhat more anarchist because America's more individualist place, I guess, for one thing. And I was influenced a lot by the situations back then, in the 60s, early 70s, which by then was over, pretty much, when we started getting hold of that on the West Coast. Anyway, that was my first experience with that sort of thing.
What has been your involvement in anarchism over the years, and what is your current
involvement? I think my original involvement with anarchism was with an independent do-it-yourself union in San Francisco. It was a white-collar public employees union, some welfare workers, clerks, hospital workers. And we didn't use the word anarchist, but it was very anti-hierarchical, no-paid people. We were not attracted to signing a contract. It was sort of wobbly-like, it was sort of IWW-like. Probably more chaotic than that, maybe, I don't know, it's the late 60s. And that was a huge experience, a learning experience. It really wasn't reading the anarchist classics that brought me into that. It was a kind of hands-on thing. What do you see when you start something that's outside of the accepted thing? We were outside of organized labor, more specifically, and we're attacked more perhaps by the big unions, the official unions, than City Hall or other, you know, business interests. And that was pretty informative. You know, it made me think that you can't be independent of the totality. Anything independent is going to be attacked on all sides. The media, for example, we'd get these really excited journalists. What an amazing experiment we have here. This is really something. The way you're doing it is really, this is going to be a big story. And we'd always say, it's not going to be a big story. It will never be published. You know, we weren't conspiratorial, but we'd seen it a bunch of times. They'd write these lovely stories and never saw the light of day. Because in San Francisco, the unions are powerful and they don't not want to hear this because it might give people ideas. So in other words, it wasn't the anarchist canon or anarchist groups. I looked around for them in the 60s and only found the Wobblies, and they're not really anarchists, they're syndicalists, and they were doing their union thing. They kind of slept right through the big adventure of the movement of the 60s. They played no part in it. So we never found any anarchists, but we were anarchists, you know, without using the AAA, I think. I'm certainly still an anarchist, and I think that anarchy means getting rid of domination, identifying what domination consists of, and the green anarchy thing, or anarcho-primitivism, called a variety of names, anti-civ, roughly speaking the same thing, is, I think, mainly adding to the list of what is domination. And certainly there are still quite a few anarchists who don't want the list lengthened. They don't see the factories, they don't see globalized, standardized life as domination. We do. We want to get rid of it. And that is split, I guess, in the anarchy situation around the world. And I think what's coming on is the green thing. And I think there are more kids that are way more turned on by that than self-managing the mass society. Anarcho-primitivism, that's kind of a mouthful. And again, these labels, they quickly solidify into ideologies, and that's a vexing problem in itself, the formation, the ideology formation dilemma. I mean, it's okay as a shorthand, but I think one of the things it is stressing the anarchy part, trying to stress the questioning and the openness, keeping it fluid instead of hardening it into a set of answers. Because I think we're trying to contribute in the sense of raising new questions. And in terms of the anarchist lineage, there are people now that don't seem to see that we're in the second decade of the 21st century. This isn't 1870 anymore. You know, Kropotkin and so forth. It's almost unavoidable that we'd have different questions or some added questions. People in the 1800s weren't quite so in a position to see where all this was leading, environmentally and psychologically even, although there was already a lot of evidence there, and some people did see it a long while ago. But the primitivist part, I think one way to say it is, there won't be a future unless it's primitive in some way or another. We simply cannot continue to assume that the industrializing, modernizing, massifying tendency can be taken for granted, can be left outside of what should be problematized. And that certainly includes technology. I think that's one of the most clear aspects of it. What is technology? It's not neutral. It's never value-free. You can read what society is in the technology. And if you come to that conclusion, then you open up a whole new dimension, I think, to what anarchy is. It isn't just sailing along, well, we have to have all this, oh, we gotta have technology. We have to have domestication, we have to have mass society, we have to have civilization. Well, why are we in this terrible crisis, this totalizing crisis that everyone can see now? If we just keep sailing along, how are we really different from the dominant culture, the dominant values that certainly wants to preserve all this and keep going forward with it? Well, the problems we face now nothing is new. We could safely say that. Nothing is totally novel. And a lot of this has been developing for the longest time, actually. But now we're seeing, to some extent, unprecedented phenomena that are systematic. And I think it's not only the unfolding, the catastrophic unfolding of what's happening to the physical world, but it's also what's happening to inner nature, the interpersonal, the social, the personal. I mean, one of the things I bring up a lot on my weekly radio broadcast is the shootings, now this sort of chronic thing where you've got these supposedly out of the blue mass shootings, multiple homicides, usually ending in suicide, so often appended with the description, this person never was a problem, never missed work, never got in an argument, never had a mental health issue, just killed 15 people. What is that saying about the nature of the civilization? Nobody seems to want to look at that. I've never seen anyone on the left go near that question. And yet, how horrific does it have to get before you can see the thing unfolding, maybe even unraveled? throat is choking up here. Should I go on with that a little bit? What often hits me, and it's kind of dismaying, is not only that people who are radical, who have something to offer in terms of what explains all this, are missing the most obvious things. I mean, where is the, this doesn't count, these shootings, for example, these pathological things that are unfolding. And of course, along the same lines, at the same time, the unfolding of the industrial disasters. It's just so clear. It's just, you know, reality pounding on the door. In other words, what's happened in the past, well, say since last summer 2010, not only the 5 million barrels of oil gushing from the Gulf of Mexico floor, but then the toxic geyser in Hungary, the sludge flowing into the Danube and into the Black Sea, the neighborhoods engulfed in natural gas leak explosions. I mean, it just goes on and on. And at the same time, though, we're always told that technology is the answer. It will provide the solution. We'll have the breakthrough. And yet what we really have is a record of disaster. And the disaster is deepening. The disaster is all part of the massive assault on not only the natural world, but all the rest of it, on the built world. It hasn't worked out. What promise has been fulfilled? And we could look at the alienation, not just something as spectacular as the shootings, that sort of thing, but the isolation, the lack of connection, the disembodied, what passes for connection among people. It's exactly the opposite of connection among people. It's machine connection. It's people living a more synthetic existence all the time, a more separate, dispersed existence. There's no community itself is almost vanished, and direct experience is almost vanished. These are epical developments, and yet you could spend your lifetime looking at leftist writings, and you wouldn't get a hint. You'd still think, you could close your eyes and think, oh, I bet this was written in maybe 1951 or something, not 2011. You know, people are just not even, you think, well, that's something to ponder, isn't it? It gets your attention. No, it doesn't. I mean, that's the danger of ideology again, to put it another way. If you're so locked into the 19th century that you can't see the disastrous course of life now, and look at the way it's spreading, and the avaricious pace of the technological change. It's just phenomenal how fast it's moving. And yet that too seems to be of no interest to what passes for radical theory. You get the big stars of philosophy now, Badiou, Zizek, two Stalinists, two Maoists. That's unbelievable. Why not two Nazis? I mean, it's just a scandal that this passes for thinking, thought, in this condition that we're in. It's just a very bitter joke. What accounts for the situation we're in, what brought it about, is the answers to that are lacking, and I think the answer to why it's lacking is interesting itself. In other words, if you implicate the whole, all of civilization, then, you know, that's not going to be welcome. That's for various reasons. What do you do with it? And besides the fact that it's too radical to pose it that way, but that's what you have to do. In other words, the question of civilization, I think, is basically the question of domestication. And I often go back to Freud's Civilization and Its Discontent, which really is about domestication. More precisely, he's talking about what happens when people are domesticated, and he concluded that you get neurotic people. You get people that have this psychic wound that never heals, because you don't get over domestication. It's a condition that is unhealthy. that has banished instinctual freedom and eros. So how could people be happy? I mean, it was a very radical insight that he had. And civilization comes on the heels of this move of taming people, and starting with taming or domesticating animals and then plants, in other words, agriculture. And various people have said it was the biggest mistake of human beings to that shift to domestication away from the foraging existence, a hunter-gatherer taking freely from nature what is provided by nature rather than engineering it and capturing it in terms of private property and farming. So, in fact, you can go further back, an even more basic social institution, which in turn sets up the domestication, which sets up civilization, is specialization, is division of labor, which seems to have labored very, very slowly along for thousands of generations, which is probably why it wasn't so much resisted. It was because all of society is incorporated or goes along with something that primary as slowly emerging specialization. But that slowly emerging specialization sets up tensions and inequalities, and one can see it if we flash back to the present. We see ourselves as completely under the effective control of specialists. We're de-skilled, we're totally reliant on different experts. Well, this began somewhere. Again, maybe almost imperceptibly, but you have these differentials, and perhaps the shaman was the first full-blown specialist with power over others. Not that that's always so malignant, but it's a condition that was not there before that. So with the movement of division of labor, that sets the stage, I think it's probably fair to say, for the advent of domestication. That's another takeoff point, but there wouldn't be the takeoff basis without the specialization coming along. And then the next move, the pivotal move of alienation, is to domesticated life. And that's exactly what we have now. It's genetic engineering and cloning and nanotech and all the rest of it. It started with farming. And this is the logical fruition. The extension is just another step of control. It's just that it's an inner logic, to use Adorno's phrase. And unless it's cut off, it continues. You just have more and more control. You have more domination of nature, and you know, with more resources to flesh it out. Flesh it out is the wrong way to put it, I guess, but to bring it along to further heights of control.
So what's it going to take to bring it down?
Well, to bring all this down, to break out of it, I think requires that we become less tolerant of some of the things that holds it all together, for example, the left. If anarchy is still going to be a flavor of the left, then we're not really going to get anywhere. That has to be ended. That there has to be a complete break with that. And by the left, I mean the historical left, including traditional classical leftist anarchism. That doesn't break with the mainstream of the dominant culture at all. And so there's a real chasm. And there really, it's not a sectarian divide. I mean, there's really some pivotal stuff at issue, and that's just the way it is. If people, again, they want mass production society, mass culture, mass consumption, then they do. And some of these people aren't willing to, on terms of the anarchist left, they're not willing to admit that. That they want to preserve all this. They really want more of it. They have a very different orientation than anarcho-primitivists. For example, one thing that's telling, I think, and has to do with the breakout, has to do with the solution, is how little respect they give the indigenous dimension, the indigenous reality. They really, the people that are leftists essentially want native people to become workers and consumers and voters. They don't see the integrity or the value of those lifeways. I'm referring back to, you know, it goes all the way back to non-domesticated people, hunter-gatherer people, nomadic hunter-gatherers or others, even horticulturalists often, who have been outside of the force field of civilization. They don't want that. They never have. Sometimes you see people kind of flirting with that, but, you know, we have to look at the consistent points of view, and I think this starts for anarchists. If we're talking about getting somewhere, I just reiterate, we won't get anywhere if we're part of the left. That is dead, and it should be dead, and we should just be dumping the dirt on its corpse and moving on. Otherwise, we don't move on. That's the first thing. And all the rest of it, if we can't deal with that, then I just don't see, because there's so much of the rest of it to tackle. But if you're hamstrung at the start by your own almost definition, if that's what your definition of anarchy is, then how can you expect some kind of solution, something? How can you expect a different vision or a different paradigm or a different model? How can you expect something that inspires people with the same old shit that nobody wants anymore? Nobody cares about the Spanish Civil War 80 years ago. They just don't. Why would they? I mean, it's interesting to some of us, but what does it have to do with right now? I mean, the part that sticks out to me, unfortunately, is keeping production going. I don't want to keep production going. I want to see the end of that. So it's an orientation that has to take itself seriously and fight for the conclusions and push on from there instead of just saying, well, we have this point of view now and we're comfortable with that. You can't be comfortable in this world with anything that counts. Yeah, it's sometimes said that the anarchist point of view is utopian in the sense that it goes against human nature. But as I like to think of the way Kevin Tucker puts it, there were human species for about 2 million years. We were hunter-gatherers, in other words, for that period of time. So wouldn't it be a more reasonable assumption to think that that's our human nature? And we see now, and this has been a huge, probably the key, maybe the key inspirational thing for anarcho-primitivism, is the revision of what is now the orthodox view of what that life was like. In other words, a life of sharing. There's absolutely no question about it in the literature, if you're looking at anthropology, ethnology, all that. That egalitarianism was the cardinal point of the ethos of hunter-gatherer life, and then the rest of it filled in by so many people, Marshall Solomons being one of my favorite, in terms of how little people had to work. I think all this has to do with human nature. In fact, actually, the term work is a modern term. Probably doesn't apply as a separate activity, as part of existence, social existence. Maybe not even a totally accurate word, but the amount of time spent somewhere or another on subsistence, very often a fraction of what we spend at modern or wage labor. And as Solomon's also pointed out, as culture moves along, people work more and more. And that's kind of interesting. The technology is promised we'd work less and less, but just as with war, I mean, civilization is chronic war, it's certainly chronic work. And so these things are imposed, it seems like. So what is the human nature part? If people, before they were defeated in their basic orientation to each other and the world, and domesticated before private property and social classes, which really start with domestication, that human nature seems to be the a priori one. I mean, that seems to be the one that obtained. So, in other words, for example, people, you also hear people say, well, it's human nature to always be changing things, always trying to improve things. You got to keep transforming stuff. Well, it wasn't really transformed for about 2 million years. In fact, that's what's always vexed the archaeologists. How did the stone tool technology, if you want to call it that, be so unchanging, and yet they knew how to take care of things? They had about the same IQ as ours a million years ago, at least. So if it's human nature to change things, and they didn't change things, then probably there's something wrong with that conception of human nature. And I would say to that, why change it if you've got a good thing going on? It was very workable. It wasn't destroying nature. It wasn't causing war. It wasn't causing stratification or hierarchy. All the things that, as anarchists, we supposedly revere and strive toward, that was the original anarchist society, not only the original affluent society, as Solomon puts it, but the original one and the only one. So that kind of, that human nature was very, very stable and workable. It was the original adaptation to the earth. In fact, the only one. There hasn't been any successful adaptation. Quite the disastrous opposite of that since civilization. The always forwarding of the attack on the unbuilt world, the attack on the natural world. So I don't know, this, it's a very modern take on what is human nature. And of course, that's the ideology of civilization. We're supposed to make those assumptions. We're supposed to just accept them and honor them. Well, it's human nature to do X, Y, and Z. Well, it wasn't for 99% of our existence, so that's just something that if we swallow, we keep it going. But if you rethink that, then it looks quite different, I think.
How optimistic are you?
Oh, I am incurably optimistic, and I'm always mocked for that, too. I guess it's probably because I sort of came of age in the 60s. When it seemed like things were really turning. It seemed like the winds were turning, as they say, and I don't know, I've never lost that feeling that a lot is possible. And I think, and maybe this is just because of that predisposition to see things in a better light somehow, I tend to emphasize how weak the system really has become. I think it has very little ideological base left. In the U.S. you have over 2 million people in prisons. And I'm just using that as an example, but I think if you don't have any greater allegiance than that and you have to fall back on coercion, if you have to fall back on brute force, you've kind of already lost the battle. And you know, in terms of the whole, speaking of ideology, I remember, at my age, I certainly remember the American dream stuff, you know, your kids will have it better than you, that's just an assumption, you know, it's getting better, there's just all these wonderful new developments. Nobody believes that anymore, and the system doesn't even bother trying to say it. It would just be, it's too laughable to say it. So, I mean, it just doesn't have any answers. It doesn't have any solutions that are cogent. I mean, you just look around and you can see that. So now, I think it's somewhat akin to locking people up. Now it's more, this is where it's at. You better get on board or you lose. You're screwed. You just don't have a choice. It isn't that it's so attractive that you rush to join. You just, I think more and more people feel just trapped. Without a choice in the matter. And so that, when you get that kind of erosion of faith in the future of the system or the goodness of the system, it shows a fragility there that we should ponder a little more. Sometimes we seem to feel so overpowered, and we are overpowered, obviously, but our enemy is weakening, I think. It's really, it's showing itself to be nothing but bad news. And so I think what has taken the place of the ideology of the dominant culture is technology. It now relies so much on technology. And even in terms of the social type questions, everything will somehow, someday, soon, magically be healed and solved and taken care of by technology. That's the last part of the ideological armory. And it works to some degree. We're all held hostage to it. We surely are. So it's not an illusion. But it's not the same as people actually believing in the different components of what is entrapping us. And that's what we have to get past. And that's as old as civilization, by the way. You know, from the first cities, which were walled cities, you can't go out there. It's very hazardous, it's dangerous nature, you'll get killed out there. It's a good thing you're safe in the city, we have the army, we have the temple, we have all this stuff, and you're secure here. It's still saying the same thing, except it isn't secure here. It's anything but secure, and really everybody knows it. There's so much anxiety in any developed country, you can cut it with a knife, and it shows, another way of showing that no one's believing in the promises, no one feels they're protected. So I think, in a way, the road is open. It's much more open than we think to get somewhere against the prevailing, still dominant controls. I think, individually, what we can do is try to see through our captivity, to understand it better and to share that, instead of, too often we accept the terms of the dialogue in any political culture, which leaves out every important question or issue. It simply does. When you look at American politics, for example, it's really nothing but trivia. There's nothing at issue. It doesn't question anything important. You know, I'm not saying that, I'm not so arrogant to say that that there are not issues that affect people, certainly, but I mean, nothing fundamental is on the table. And we have to stop that. We have to interrupt that. And it's harder to do individually, but that's part of it too, though. And I think that's just speaking out and just interrupting the false, the kind of phony or pseudo dialogue that takes place in society, and start injecting it with some reality. That's all it is. It's just, it's really that simple. This is a great nation of denial. It's probably the most completely in denial one of it. I don't know about that for sure, but so it's not easy. I think individually, I don't think it's a positive thing to be told, which the dominant culture does tell us every day, and I'm sure it's not just in America, that if you recycle more or take a shorter bath or something like that, you will have some real impact. You won't. It's just a lie. I think I look at recycling as just making room for more production. None of this stuff has any meaningful reality, and of course, we hear about green and sustainable endlessly, and I've seen it in India, actually, and not just the U.S., of course, but... and it's easier, if you want to console people, they need to have some sense that they can do something. They can vote, they can be more assiduous in their recycling, or whatever it is, these things that are just a compensation, and actually only strengthen the system. They're nothing about the solution. I'm sorry, but it's a waste of time. You have to look at where does the energy and the water go, for example, if you're looking at your personal consumption habits that only reinforces the consumerist mentality. But that's another thing we can each do, is see through that and reject that and not just keep it to ourselves. We can mock these things that I think so many people know it's just a joke, but it's socially reinforced if we just go along with it. Oh, it's counterintuitive to say that these things are not helpful. But insofar as they're not helpful, it's our job, I would say, to point that out. And then other people can feel encouraged and emboldened to, we can all go a little further if we each, point out the lies. And it's more comfortable to just go along with it, of course, but that's something we could do. Well, on the other hand, we know that anarcho-primitivism certainly means the death of billions of people, almost all of the billions of people, let's face it. And Professor Noam Chomsky points this out very well. He's called us genocidists. He's pointed out that it would be not just the unintended consequence of if there was somehow a primitivist shift, but it's the desired consequence. Of course, this is real deceit. This is just it's really hard to believe. But I think actually it's just the opposite. People like Chomsky and lots of other people, they're the ones who don't really care about the 6 billion people. They're the ones who want to see them staying in these cities, mega cities especially, in these tower block apartments, where when everything fails, they'll be dead in a few days because they have no skills, they have no access to getting along without the whole artificial aspects of modernity. We're talking about reskilling ourselves and spreading that information. And I think there's a great psychological bonus to that, by the way. I don't pretend to be very far along on that road at all, but one thing I'm struck by, people who have reskilled in terms of knowing how to start a fire, or find edible plants, or make a shelter, or make simple tools, they are much more likely, I think, to be fighters, because if you think that if you want to pull down civilization and you don't know how to live without it, you probably hesitate on some level or other in your pulling it down, your desire to pull it down. It can't be as full a desire if you're not ready for what can follow, if you're not even thinking about it. So I think that's an important aspect. That's to reverse the picture, I think it's not just I'm not just being rhetorical here, but we're the ones that I think are thinking about the 6 billion people far more than those who just blithely not only accept but promote this direction we're going in, this suicidal, poisonous, pathological train we're on. If you don't question that, you don't give a damn about the 6 billion people, because you're consigning them to what is already unfolding. All the major cities of the world, you can't breathe the air. So, we've got to keep on industrializing. We've got to bring factories everywhere. That is the opposite of our position. Again, because we're thinking about life on this earth, and I don't think the people who are making these fantastic charges against us have the right to say that they're the ones that are concerned about it. Anarcho-primitivism has been accused of largely continuing the noble savage myth, and I plead guilty, because there was a noble savage, and it's very hip to scoff at that, to jeer at that, and that doesn't mean that we think there was some perfect Eden or something like that, certainly not, but compared to this nightmare now, especially, and given what we learn from the standard literature, without having to make up anything or inflate anything or go into rhapsodies about the absolute perfection of hunter-gatherer life, we know how workable it was. Noble or not noble, but the savage life was much superior. It simply was. Anarcho-primitivism, so-called, first started getting around. There was maybe more of a kind of, I don't know if you could call it kind of purist point of view, that if it wasn't nomadic hunter-gatherer, then it wasn't, then it was horrible and it wouldn't be worth pursuing. That would certainly be the goal. And that hasn't been eclipsed, I would say. I don't think that's been lost sight of. I think it's fairly clear that's kind of an ideal anti-hierarchical condition, the nomadic part, before you get to sedentism. But on the other hand, I think there are people, including Kevin Tucker, who have written persuasively that there are a lot of small-scale horticulture-based societies that have been exemplary, that have not fallen into the usual things that come from domestication. And, you know, and some of this, again, the domestication thing is the watershed. For example, people say, oh, you're all in love with the primitive, but what about cannibalism or genital mutilation or human sacrifice or, you know, stuff like that? Well, none of those things existed before domestication. So I think it's more important to keep that in mind as a general thing rather than try to say that we're going to have some litmus test or blueprint or something like that in terms of a return.